Okay, so I said before that we made this discovery. We observed the Higgs decaying in different channels, gamma-gamma first and for lepton, Zz2 for lepton, and then tau-tau, and then BB-bar. Recently we had evidence of the Higgs 2 mu-mu with 3 sigma, and I mean it's clear that what we observed is what predicted by Peter Higgs. What we are not sure is that if there are additional particles, and so what we observed is just one between many Higgs bosons, okay? And a way to check this is to check for any possible deviation of the measurements expected from standard model and the experimental observations. One way to do that is to measure the couplings of the Higgs with all the other particles. We said at the beginning that the Higgs couples to fermions, to gauge bosons, and also to itself. Okay. So there is a kind of formalism which is called the Kappa framework, which parameterize the cross-section for the production of the Higgs and the decay in terms of cross-section for the initial production of the Higgs times the partial width for the decay of the Higgs in the final state divided by the total width. So this is essentially the branching fraction. Under the hypothesis of the zero width, because the Higgs is a resonance with very, very narrow width, 14 MeV. Okay. And by using a tensor structure of the Lagrangian, which is the one of the standard model, so 0 plus, and defining this K factor as the ratio between either the cross-section with respect to the standard model and or the partial decay width with respect to the standard model prediction. So essentially what you do is to measure this gamma in the different final state and compare with the standard model. So you expect that this kind of ratio tends to be equal to 1 if there is a matching with the standard model. No. If you have deviations from unity, then you start to claim for new physics. So a way for looking for new physics was to look for deviations of this K factor from 1. Okay, and you have here the definition of all of this K factor for all the particles and for also different production mode. And essentially the LHC collaborations are getting measurements of this K factor as an indirect measurements of the coupling of the Higgs to other particles. Okay. And you see, for example, here that Kz, Kw, K top, Kb, K tau, K gamma, K gluon, K mu are quite consistent with the unity, apart this one, which is at the moment is not very well constrained. And essentially, and here also we have, sorry, this was third, I don't know why, but anyway. But essentially what we measured in terms of this kappa factor is generally quite consistent with the unity, so with the standard model. Of course, we tried also to look at additional operators entering in the Lagrangian of the standard model, what are called operators from the effective field theories, and try to get constraint on the parameter of this additional contributors to the Lagrangian. And so, again, apart from some cases, there is a large convergence on the standard model. So, at the end of the run 2, so at the end, I mean, we didn't finish yet the analysis of run 2 data. What we learned? We learned that the standard model is quite robust. It should not be the ultimate theory of particle physics because of many questions. Why the Higgs boson is so light? What is the nature of dark matter of the universe? What's the origin of the matter-antimatter asymmetry? Why the gravity is so weak? Is supersymmetry realized in nature? What is the mechanism for the inflation? All of these questions are still open. And we had no access in data for sign, direct sign of new physics, no sign of supersymmetry, no sign of long life particle, no sign of new heavy resonance, no sign of dark matter. Maybe because all of these things happen at higher energy, and so we need to increase the energy of the accelerator, or just to take more data. We don't know. But at the same time, doing precision measurements can be an indirect sign of BSL physics. So if we measure something which deviates from the prediction of the standard model, that could be a sign of new physics. Okay. And now we are here. We just started with the run 3. But after 3 years, we will have another stop of about 3 years, and then we will run in the high luminosity LHC regime for about 10 years. So with luminosity that will be 5 times the nominal one, the one that was planned, and so collecting about 3,000 inverse femtobarn of data after 10 years. With all of this data, we should be able to explore at least some of the answers, to give some answers to this question, or to those, or to have a solid answer for excluding or getting evidence of one of these issues. Okay. So there is a large plan of physics for the high luminosity LHC scenario, and in this set of slides there are many predictions about that, but I prefer to switch now to what we are still doing for the run 2 and we will do for the run 3. And I will leave you the part for the high luminosity LHC in the slides. I will give you in the slides, so then you can understand what could be the physics that we will do in 10 years from now with the LHC. Okay. So you will find many slides about that. Instead, I prefer now to move to something else related to the Higgs, and which is what we are currently doing. Okay. So, can we switch to the other file? Next one. Anyway, I will leave the slides to the other people, so then you can have a look eventually, okay? And understand what could be done after a few years, at least 6 years from now, for the high luminosity LHC, okay? So essentially, CMS and ATLAS at least will cover the next 15 years for data taking and measurements, okay? After that, we could probably have a future circular collider much bigger than the LHC to run at 100 TV. That's the project we are also working now, the R&D, and that will be probably the future of particle physics, experimental particle physics, okay? Now, what I want to mention is the double Higgs searches and the constraints on the Higgs self-coupling. Why this topic is so important? Because you have studied the Higgs mechanism. You have studied the Higgs potential. And you notice that in the Higgs potential, there is a contribution coming from the Higgs coupling with itself. We are talking about the triple Higgs coupling or the quartic Higgs coupling. Okay. So this is the triple Higgs coupling, but then you have other diagrams with four Higgs particles. Okay. Why it's fundamental to look at these couplings? Because they will be fundamental to understand the shape of the potential, of the Higgs potential. We could not be sure about the Higgs mechanism until we don't measure these couplings. Okay, those couplings, the triple and the quartic couplings, are predicted by the standard model once you know the mass of the Higgs. And we know the mass. But then we have to measure these couplings. And if we have, if we find the value expected in the standard model, we will be sure about the Higgs mechanism. And so the shape of the potential, because this lambda that we will discuss now, it's the same lambda which appears in the Higgs potential. Okay, it's the triple Higgs coupling and then the quartic Higgs coupling. They are the same. And how to look for these couplings, which are fundamental to understand the shape of the Higgs potential? Well, the way we do is, as you could see here, to look for the double Higgs production. Let me show you the Lagrangian. No, you have seen this Lagrangian and the expansion. Then you see here, you have a quartic coupling, a triple coupling. You see, this is the triple coupling and this is the quartic coupling. Now, if you want to access to this triple coupling, I mean, this is feasible with the LHC, okay? But the quartic coupling is out of reach of the LHC. Why? Because the cross-section to produce four Higgs is much, much lower than what could be explored by the LHC. Okay. So we will focus on this, on the production of double Higgs, and on the measurements of the Higgs trilinear self-coupling. According to the standard model, if the Higgs is 125 GeV, this lambda value should be about 0.13. So once we will measure this, if we found deviation from this value, that could be a sign of new physics. But first we need to measure it. Okay. And how do we parameterize this? Again, via a kappa factor, which is the lambda that you observe divided by the lambda value expected by the standard model. So this is 0.13. Okay. And so, in the last few years, the study of the production of double Higgs via diagrams like this one became very important, competitive. Okay. We just had a result for the paper published on Nature that was made public 15 days ago for the Higgs anniversary. Okay, so if you look in Google and check for Nature journal and papers published in the last release, you will find the papers by Atlas and CMS. And in the paper of CMS, you will find the very latest results about the double Higgs production. So our latest results. So we will talk now about the very latest achievement we got this year for the double Higgs production. So look at the cross-section. Of course, here you could have gluon-gluon fusion as for the single Higgs, or other production mechanism, vector boson fusion, this one, associate production, or TT bar double Higgs production, okay? Like for the single Higgs, with the difference that now we have two Higgs boson. This is virtual, and those are real. Okay? Pay attention that in the standard model we don't have a resonance, we don't have a particle decaying into Higgs. So if we observe a resonance, that for sure is a sign of new physics. Okay, so that's a very important topic, actually. Here I will discuss only the non-resonant production, so essentially what is predicted by the standard model. Okay. And as you could see, we start from a cross-section which is 31 femtobar. Very, very small. Then you have to multiply the cross-section times the branching ratio related to the decay of the Higgs boson, for each of the two Higgs boson. Okay, so that makes the probability even lower. The cross-section times branching ratio will be even lower. So it's really hard. And indeed, we cannot manage to measure this kappa lambda, so the coupling with the RAN2. We need more statistics. We need more data. We are almost close to the sensitivity for measuring lambda, kappa lambda, but we are not able yet to have evidence of that, because we just need to collect more data. The cross-section is very small, and as you can imagine, there is a large number of theorists that are now studying the cross-section for the double Higgs production, for all the post-production mode, with the highest precision, next to leading order, and next to leading order, and more. Okay. And the LHC-X cross-section working group is trying to compute all the possible contribution to the cross-section. Okay. Also, I mean, there is an effort to evaluate this cross-section not only when k lambda is equal to 1, which corresponds to the standard model prediction, but also when you have deviation of kappa lambda from 1, which is a sign of new physics. Okay. And so you compute the cross-section as a function of kappa lambda, and you will see, I mean, that there is a kind of behavior with the value at kappa lambda equal to 1, which corresponds to the standard model, and then other contributions which are very likely related to non-standard model physics. Okay. So you have here, for example, in the case of the gluon-gluon fusion, for kappa lambda equal to 2.4, you have a minimum of the cross-section. For the VBF production, the vector boson fusion production of the double X, you have a minimum at around 1.65. So according to this prediction, you put in place a selection analysis for different final states. There is also the possibility to have three new contact interactions, so with additional coefficients, couplings. This is more in the heft, okay, as is predicted in the heft, X-effective field theory. And it's again, in case those couplings are measured and different from zero, this could be a sign of new physics. Okay, so we are studying, we made a scan of this parameter and we got different distributions for kinematical variables. Here is the Di Higgs invariant mass, and we are studying measuring this, trying to measure actually to get constraint on these parameters by using this Yermak state. Okay, this is a detail right now. So at 125 data GV, we measured this branching ratio for the Higgs. We know those from the theory. Okay, but now we are looking for double Higgs. So you have to look for final state combining all the possible decays of the Higgs. Okay. And actually, until now, the most sensitive channels, not because of the branching ratio, but because of the topology, are those three. 4b, okay, this is the most probable one because the X decays in BB bar with 58% of branching ratio. But then you have also the second X decaying in BB bar. So the 4b, BB tau tau, and BB gamma gamma. But many others final state, combination of final state of the X were studied. Okay. They are just less sensitive than those three, okay? And it's clear, since you have to reconstruct the Higgs in BB bar, that again, you have to rely on the deep neural network to get a B-tagging algorithm working at the best possible, in the best possible way, okay? And here, I just mention the strategy used for the 4B analysis, which is a quite complex analysis, because, I mean, to be sure that the four jets are B jets, and the way to combine them to build the double X candidate is not trivial. It's not trivial because you have a large background. And so you have to find the best way to reconstruct this double X from 4B by using advanced advanced techniques like a BDT, a boosted decision tree, okay, or a neural network. Okay. And here there is a description of the pairing of the jets to get the two Higgs candidates. It's a detail right now, but you can have a look at that. And of course, you have to keep under control all the possible sources of systematic uncertainty. And some of them come from the theory related to the calculations about the cross-section provided by theorists, provided to us by theorists, no? And some are experimental based systematics. Okay. Mostly related to the our understanding of the b-tagging efficiency and related to our modeling of the background. So we have to be sure that we can control the background. Otherwise, if we observe something and we're not sure about the background, we are giving, wrong, we are getting a wrong measure. And, I don't know where it's done, okay. So this analysis was able to constrain the K lambda between, as you could see, minus 2.5 and 9.5. What does it mean? So, kappa lambda equal to 1 is the standard model. And this is the upper limit on the production cross-section when the two Higgs decay in BB bar. And essentially, the standard model is here. And a scan on kappa lambda was done to understand if some values of kappa lambda could be excluded. And that's the case. So all the value of kappa lambda outside this interval are excluded. Okay. So we are constraining kappa lambda. The same could be done also for the vector boson fusion. This is for the gluon-gluon fusion plus the vector boson fusion. In the case of the vector boson fusion, there is another coupling which is introduced, and it is the coupling of the two Higgs, let me show you, of the two Higgs with the two, this one, K2V, of the two Higgs with the two W or Z boson. This is what is called KVV or K2V or C2V. And so we were also computing constraints on these couplings. And this is the result. This is done with just one analysis, the 4B. But then we had also BB gamma gamma. This is the results from Atlas. Again, here a brief sketch of the strategy for the analysis, which is also quite complex here, and also is mostly based on a multivariate analysis approach. So by using neural networks, boosted decision trees, random forest, and all the possible machine learning tools. And again, here, you could get a constraint on the kappa lambda that you see is much better than what we got for the 4B analysis. So we are constraining kappa lambda in a much narrower range, which means that kappa lambda tends to be very likely compatible with the standard model. Okay, but still we need to squeeze this range to be sure about that. Okay. So this is the constraint on kappa lambda from BB to gamma gamma. They also explored other options with other parameters like this one, which is the K2V or the C to V, as I mentioned before, for the vector boson fusion. And also the measurements from the BB gamma gamma and 4B was complemented also by the BB tau tau. So this is another analysis which is very sensitive. It's looking for double X in the final state BB tau tau with tau decaying hadronically. So in one prong, two prongs, so tau decaying in pions plus neutrinos. Okay. And again here there is a complex strategy to discriminate the signal from the background with the use of again multivariate analysis technique. You see boosted decision trees or neural networks. Now those techniques are quite common because this kind of analysis are quite difficult and it's very hard to discriminate the signal from the background. And in this case what was obtained is a constraint on the standard model on the production cross-section which is the upper limit which is about 12 times the standard model. What does it mean? It means that we are not sensitive yet to the measurements of this trilinear coupling by using CMS and Atlas-D. Okay. Here there is a study about another channel, BBZZ, when the 2Z decaying in lepton, and so you have BB for lepton. And again, a constraint on kappa lambda and on the cross-section. This is the combination of the BB tau tau and BB gamma gamma analysis done by Atlas, where you could see that the upper limit on the cross-section is about three times the standard model prediction. What does it mean? It means that until we don't reach an upper limit close to one, we could not probe if kappa lambda is equal to one, as expected from the standard model, or could be different, and there could be new physics. Okay, so by using Atlas analysis, we just got three times an upper limit on the production cross-section, which is three times the standard model prediction. And here is the constraint on kappa lambda, which is, as you could see, good, but it's not here definite. So you have still a large range of variation of kappa lambda. So the possibility that there is deviation from kappa lambda equal to 1, so from the standard model, is still open. Okay. Now, I said we are combining different analysis, but what does it combination means? Combination means a statistical combination. So imagine the techniques of best fit that you probably used in the lab or at the time that you were doing very small experiments. You have to use advanced techniques to fit your experimental data with the simulation. And the results of those fits needs to be combined for different analysis to get a better constraint. So if I measure something with a technique, I measure the same thing with another technique, then I want to combine the results of both the techniques to get a better constraint. That is what we do in time for combination. In our case, it's a statistical combination, which is use what is called an inference tool for people in CMS. This is something that could be used as an exercise. It's quite complex and allows you to get a certain number of plots. Those are statistically relevant plots. It means that they are upper limit on the cross-section, upper limit on kappa lambda, profile likelihood, significance, any possible kind of plot as output or as an input for the fitting procedure. Okay? And many things are parametrized. For example, the way the cross-section depends on kappa lambda and also kt, kappa top, is parametrized in terms of a formula, which seems to work very well. And the same for the Wirthold boson production. Here there are plots which have been turned, I don't know why. But let me go to the results. So this is the main result for the combination of the CMS double X analysis. And as you could see, CMS, in addition to the 4B, BB tau tau and BB gamma gamma, included also other analysis, what are called multilectern, which is BBWW, BBZZZZ, and also BBZZ. And this, you can see that those two analyses are less sensitive than the first three. That gives you an expected limit of about 2.5 with respect to the standard model prediction. So one, we will reach one, and this will take probably all the statistics of the run tree. We become sensitive to the double X production, at least in the context of the standard model. So, and then we could have evidence with 3 sigma, and after some time with more data, we could really observe the double X production. This is the target for the high luminosity LHC, actually. Okay. And so this is one of the hot topic right now, because clearly, if we are able to observe the double X, we can get information about the triple X coupling. And if the prediction from the standard model is correct, then we can definitely confirm the reality of the X mechanism to give masses to the particle. Okay, so that's fundamental for our research, actually. Yeah, there are many other technical plots that probably are too technical to be described here. I just want to mention that CMS and Atlas got slightly different results on each channel, even if the CMS result is better in terms of expected limit with respect to Atlas. Atlas got a better observed limit on the cross-section for the production. Okay, they are compatible, but essentially what we got from this research is an upper limit on the cross-section for the production, which is about 3 times the standard model. So as I said, we are not yet sensitive to the standard model prediction. We are constraining kappa lambda in a narrow range, and let me conclude that the search for double X production will shed light on the shape of the standard model X potential, reveal new physics through the effect of anomalous coupling. The combination of double X analysis with full RAM2 data is not yet over. For the Nature paper, which was published, I said, 10 days ago, which was made public, we just used the 5 analysis. But there are many others which are in progress. And so we could probably improve our result from CMS. Then there is a plan of getting a combination between the results from CMS and the results from Atlas to get an even better constraint on kappa lambda and even better constraint on the production cross-section. Okay. And I skipped several technical details, but you can also find many details in the backup. For example, this is a projection of our result with the high luminosity LHC statistics of data. And what we can see is that we will have a significance of 3 sigma for each experiment, almost 3 sigma, at the end of the high luminosity LHC, so after collecting 3,000 in dense factor. But those are projections. What does it mean? That you have your measurement done now, and you try to extrapolate it to what will happen in 10 years from now. And generally, this is a very pessimistic projection. So we can definitely do better, and we could probably reach a 5 sigma discovery of the double X after a few years of collecting data for the high luminosity LHC. And I think that will be really a good success of the research for the high luminosity LHC. Of course, if then we observe a new signal, that will open many, many other possibilities for the future. Okay. And then I think I can stop here without bothering you with so many details. Okay. Do you have questions? Of course, I can provide you all the possible documentation. I just skipped many details just because I want to give you an overview without, since you are not specialized in this kind of things. But if somebody is interested even to contribute, to make a thesis, to work for a thesis, master thesis, PhD thesis, those are the topics that we are studying now, so there is space for contribution if somebody is interested. Okay. Okay. Thanks then. Yeah, I think I'm in time.